first question. Everything else, we have no idea where this is going to go. We're just going to have a conversation and pretend they're not here. And we're just going to chat, right? Okay.
Absolutely.
So the first thing I ask of my show Still Rising is a question that most black and brown people are asked a lot. So it's, where are you from?
And how long?
And came
late Windrush. My mum earlier than my dad. It was in the forces. So I'm actually born in Germany, which makes me extremely British, actually, if you do the history. I started school in Hong Kong. I didn't actually come to live in London until I was 7. So the from is, there's a lot of Jamaica in there, but we know that.
In fact, the first person I said I was a poet to, yeah, what do you do? I'm a poet. And we ended up starting a poetry group called 3+1. I was the plus one. That just took off from there. So at 19, I realized I was a poet. At 19, I realized that all of the things that I did, that I was focusing on, the performing arts, the English, the bedrooms, everything, I realized that all of that was about being a performance poet. And then I found the poetry stage. So she had places she was performing, but they were much more kind of shiny, it was industry stuff or whatever. And I wanted her to come down and get appreciation for her actual gift. So I invited her down and we had this piece that we did. It was actually at a show that was called Poets versus MCs. Poets.
If someone has the pleasure of hearing this for the first time, I wish I was there. On the sound. So the last time I saw Livingston, he reminded me, was in LA when he was working with Barrington Levi. Livingston on sound is the man. I just wanted to hear that because obviously we're going to go into what happened with Floetry, etc. But I still feel that's a really important song for us to hear on your journey.
We can start.
There you go. Hey. All right, but they got to hear that intro though. Leave me some backing up so they can hear it from the very first beat. Please. I'm just thinking from the UK, from London.
From London's SE5, which is where I was. I was in Camberwell Green. When I left Philly to go to, that's where Dad bought me the apartment, bless his heart.
Trying
to be in uni.
Trying to keep on the right path.
Probably a venue, basically.
Yeah. And you took
full advantage of it.
Let's hear it. No, I got here for the first beat, I'm sorry.
Was I wrong?
You sound like you don't, because you sound completely in control of your craft. Mm. So this is what I say to people about coming out too soon sometimes, and I feel like I came out too soon in many ways as in my musical career, because I've been acting so much. And my stage growth works on singing, and then everyone thought you were going to be a singer. It's like you, but people had your career sorted for you. But then I started working as an actress, and so I was like, I'm a singer, but I'm going to write this acting thing until I can get a record deal. But what you don't realize is, my A&R man said to me, I wanted this person to work with you, and they refused. And I said, why did they refuse? And this guy said about me, why would I work with her when there are musicians who've been working and honing their craft for years, and she's been on TV acting? I'd rather work with someone who's dedicated to music. And you know what? I had to accept that, because I had to accept that I love music and I'd be working on it, but I had diverted. And you're trying to prove yourself to people, but sometimes you just have to accept that people are going to have their preconceived idea. And if anything, it really made me work hard, because I realized quite quickly that when I was out on the scene, it wasn't school anymore. People have been doing this.
Yeah.
For your Donnies.
Yeah.
I've been working with Donnie.
Yeah.
And crying, like going home and crying and going, I'm not there. Like, I am. He was really kind to me, actually, Donnie. Mm. But I just remember thinking,
Donnie's great.
And he gave me a singing teacher. He gave me a singing teacher called Glyn. He was Welsh, and you say, only the Welsh and the blacks can sing. And he had a bar at the end. Only the Welsh and the blacks can sing bar.
Yeah.
And he used to. And so my record company, my management said to me, I was the most improved artist they'd had on their books, because I very quickly realized that I had to really work on that craft, really, really work on it. But you guys come out with your first record and all I hear is the craft. Like, you must have put in your 10,000 hours, as they say.
Oh, there's a lot of study, definitely. There's performance study, but it's live, you know? And going to the States, if you can't perform live, it's just not gonna happen, you know? So we were ready to go live, and you had the study that Marshall had obviously done vocally, which they're very adaptive, but there's holding a stage, and that's my forte, you know, interacting with the audience. What you do between the songs, how do you link it all, how do you join it, what's the message, why are they there? And we were ready for that, you know. I was ready for that. I was ready to meet my audience. It's something that had been brewing within me for a very long time, from very young. So I wanted to meet every single person, like, oh, they're all here, this is interesting, what can I share, why are we in the same space? And that was a deep focus. So you had this blending, I mean, that's what poetry is about, poetic delivery of musical intent. You had a blend of studio skills, you know, top lines, vocals, backgrounds, all that, but you had content, you had intention. You had purpose, you had almost, you know, some of those songs are like little movies, you know, Sunshine, Mistress, they're not Headache, they're not just, you know, 2 minutes 30, how do I get it on the radio, they're how does this become an impactful part of somebody's life, what's it about, you know? And I think that's what a lot of the magic, especially in that first album, was, because it was very organic, it was very free, not much got involved, it was based on what it was based on, you know, what it was based on for a while. It was safe in that way. Floetic is 22 years old. My nephew was born the day that album came out. So I get to see how all this stuff is. He's got a beard and he drives and he's got a company and stuff and says, hello, auntie.
Thank you, Robbie.
I'm
a fan. they said to you, it's the maturity, it's the authenticity, it's the craft. And I feel like you guys were, in America, you guys were everyone's favorite Brit. You guys were
talking about.
Okay, yes, please.
Here she goes.
She promises a lot, doesn't she?
Hey, what?
She keeps us waiting in suspense.
Okay, I'll do it here.
What was it like working with him?
Michael Jackson was fantastic. He just wanted us to do well.
You say that, I'm going to tell you something that I've never told you, right? So,
okay.
Michael Jackson sang your song exactly.
Yeah, how he heard it.
Right.
Yeah.
My friend produced Michael Jackson's album. And the reason, it was one with Tommy Mottola and Rodney Jerkins, my friend was part of that team. And the reason that album was about 2 years late was because every time they went in the studio, and the song, Tommy Mottola, who was his A&R man at the time, would say, Michael, this is perfect, this is perfect, get it out. And Michael would turn around and say to them, I want to try the verse of the chorus is the verse, the bridge is. And he used to change each song over and over again. He was never, ever satisfied. They were just like, Michelle, it's impossible, because he will not. The reason that album was late was purely because Michael Jackson kept changing each song, okay? So those were his own songs that he wrote with Rodney Jerkins and Harvey Mason Jr. Yet here's your song. Not his.
Yeah,
he didn't change anything.
Michael was very radical, you know, and he liked to do deservedly things the way he wanted to do them, and he wanted to make a statement with us, and he wanted to champion us and just show what he thought of our creativity. Here, you can play that.
But that's such a beautiful thing.
Oh, beautiful offering. And he was trying, Michael knows what that industry is like. And he wanted us to come in with a stamp of approval, you know. Soon after Michael did that, Prince came, Stevie came, and they all came and gave their stamp of approval. Patti LaBelle, you know, they would all make their way.
Hey Mike, where did you get butterflies from?
From Irvine, these two girls on Floetic, and they came with the song, and we kind of worked together. It's mainly the other two girls who mainly composed that one.
Wow.
And I think they're British. They're British girls. They're Black British girls, and they were just phenomenal. And I thought it was something I really, really liked. So we did some kind of counter, you know, hooks and lines, painting different sounds and everything, different colors. And so we produced it, and I produced it, and just created something that was just acceptable. And it's a book on the album.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for blessing. Thank you for blessing us with that.
You're welcome. You're welcome.
Thank you. So you were everyone's favorite group, and then it came to second album. And notoriously, if you're not in the music industry, the second album is always a pressure. So your first album blows up. It actually makes your second album a real pressure, because you want to evolve and grow, because you're learning your craft. You want to move it on, but people get very nervous when they've paid you in advance to make an album. Because once something becomes a hit, they want you to repeat it. They don't want you to change, because they feel like you've got a winning formula. We don't change that. It becomes very much about commerce. How did that second album go for you?
Well, we had interesting things happen. DreamWorks started to fold. The but the industry started to really change. So we got like an interim record. So we did Floacism, which was a live album DVD. John wanted to make sure everyone saw our live show because that was at the heart of it all. And then we went over to Geffen. So the sophomore record is actually Flowology, but it's actually our third release, but it's our second studio album. Things have really changed by then.
Find your gift, your purpose in life is to give it away, right? So you found your gift and you just give. As far as I can see of you, I see how you are with your purpose. I see the joy you get from what they do. No shade, no envy, just pride. But today's your day. Today I want to hear you. So this is for you.
Okay.
I
submit, I come, I get better, and I love you. Wherever we go, whatever I choose, I want it cause I want it, I want it cause I want it. Whatever it is, I'm gonna give it cause I got it. It's gonna show cause I want it.
Running.
I'm sure we are.
So
I told you we went to
chat. Yeah, we chat. So, because this was from